Good afternoon. I'm Vali Nasr, the Dean of Johns Hopkins University School of Advanced International Studies. And it's my pleasure to welcome everybody to this session, and also it's my honor to welcome His Excellency Brian Mikkelsen, Minister for Industry, Business and Financial Affairs of the Kingdom of Denmark, to discuss free trade and globalization as part of our Dean's Forum lecture series. And I had pleasure to meet the minister very recently in Denmark, and he promised to visit SAIS on his next visit to Washington, and we're very grateful that he had an opportunity to come to Washington in such short order and that we are able to host him during his visit. Now, for 70 years, SAIS has served as a platform for policymakers and students to engage on the crucial issues shaping our world events. Today's session is in partnership with our European and Eurasian Studies program, and it continues in the tradition of dialogue by bringing leaders and practitioners in international business, trade, and finance to share their experiences with our students, faculty, and the broader community in Washington, D.C. Minister Mikkelsen has over 20 years of service in the Danish government, where he was first elected in 1994 as a member of the Conservative People's Party. He has since had a distinguished career serving as Minister of Culture from 2001 to 2008, Minister of Justice from 2008 to 2010, Minister for Economic and Business Affairs between 2010 and 2011, and Minister for Industry, Business and Financial Affairs since 2016. As Finance Minister, Minister Mikkelsen also acted as Ex-Officio Member of the Board of Governors of the European Bank of Reconstruction and Development, the European Investment Bank, and the Nordic Investment Bank. He has been a strong proponent of Denmark's membership in European Union's single market and is eager to bring Denmark to the forefront of digital development. Minister Mikkelsen has also served on the board or on executive committees for numerous organizations, including the World Anti-Doping Agency and the Danish Olympic League Forum. Today, we're fortunate to learn from his years of experience in governance and his work as a senior policymaker in promoting national consensus on improving Danish business environment and accelerating economic growth, and is also his perspective on broader global issues involving trade and financial relations across various markets. Please join me in welcoming Minister Brian Mikkelsen.
Dear Dean Vali Nasr, thank you especially for the right pronunciation of my name. Usually you call me Brian, but my name is actually in Danish Brian. Dear students at this very famous, well-known university, thank you all for joining me here today. I really appreciate giving this talk and afterwards talking to you, giving comments, answering questions. You come here as students to Johns Hopkins, a university based on the founding mission to bring discovery to the world. You have a proud history, tradition in education, research and service around the globe, with research and training programs on every continent, and more than 400 undergraduate students studying abroad in dozens of countries each year, and more than 193,000 alumni living in 175 different countries. I'm really impressed because that's almost all the countries in the world. You miss people from about 25 countries. I think it's safe to say that Johns Hopkins is truly an international and globally oriented university. Your dean just presented me. I've been in politics for many years, working with especially economy and culture and justice affairs. But I've been very involved because I've been sitting in the government's leadership. We call it a coordination committee. For almost all the years I've been in government, where we have coordinated also our foreign policy, so I'm also very involved in that. I'm a firm believer not only in the European cooperation, but also in free trade and globalization. And that's why I have very strong ideas about what's going on right now in the world, and also with the tweets from President Trump. But I will come back to that. Traditionally, Denmark has have very strong relationship with America. And we share a common ambition to create new industries, companies, and workplaces. We are actually very proud of our relationship to America. Our number one biggest trading partner outside of Europe. We are exporting for more than 100 billion Danish kroner. It's our third biggest partner. As I told you, the biggest one outside of Europe. We are a very small country. I can disclose for you that we are only about 6 million people. And being a very small and open economy, relying on the import and export of goods and services, Denmark is highly dependent on international trade. Our history is trade. Not just starting off with the Vikings 1,000 years ago. They were just not making wars or raping women or anything. No, they were traders. Going abroad from Denmark, trying to trade things, and sometimes they were a little bit violent, but they were traders. And since then, we have been trading with other nations, so we have regarded ourselves as merchants and a trading nation. We don't have anything in our natural resources at home at all in the Danish ground. We have a little bit of oil out in the North Seas, but we have to rely on skills, on education, on our trading skills. Like Johns Hopkins University, most Danish companies are globally orientated because of that. And about half of the jobs in the private sector are directly related to exports. This affects up to a third of all people employed in Denmark, and this year's exports are expected to account for 50% of growth in the Danish economy. Therefore, Denmark is a very strong advocate for free trade and fair trade. And those I come to the States with an agenda to discuss how to intensify our common commercial cooperation based on free and fair trade. On this note, I will begin this talk by quoting the Nobel Prize winner, Cordell Hull, who said that, and I quote him, "Trade barriers are barriers also to lasting peace." Hull was a powerful politician with a strong belief that free trade was the road to world peace. In my opinion, Hull was one of the most important forgotten men of the 20th century. Because as much as any single person, Hull was helped create the free trade world we live in today. But you don't hear much about him anymore. He had a big revelation about peace and free trade during World War I. He was actually a US congressman from Tennessee. And at that time, he thought Germany and France wouldn't have needed to fight in the trenches if they had traded more with each other. If there were thousands of businessmen, as he was saying, in Paris, in Berlin, yelling, saying to their governments, "Hey, don't shoot my customers." He became Secretary of State under FDR, under Roosevelt, but with the Great Depression and the rise of fascism, the 1930s were not a good time to be an internationalist pushing free and fair trade. At that time, people thought he was nuts. He said, "The reasons why there's a Nazi Germany is because they don't trade enough." People said, "That's not just it, he's off base." What finally changed things for Hull was World War II. As the US started thinking about how to rebuild the world after the war, Hull's message suddenly started to make more sense. His case was this: if people are trading with one another, they'll have a vested stake in preserving peace. And the president strongly supported all of this, and that was Hull's moment. US companies and unions looked at the world and saw that their foreign competition had been bumped to dust during the war. Western Europe was devastated, Japan was devastated, and they needed American products. And America needed to create jobs for the veterans coming home from war, so this was a win-win from the United States. That's why the Marshall Help was created, and that's why there was a sentiment in the States for opening up. So the companies and unions went to Congress and say, let's lower tariffs all over the world. And it happened. After the war, whole stream of free trade came through. The US and more than 20 other countries created GATT, the General Agreement on Tariff and Trade. And GATT was an international machine for lowering tariffs. At the end of the war, the average tariffs on imports to the US was around 30%. Today, it's roughly about 5%. Hall won the Nobel Peace Prize in 1945, partly for his work on the United Nations, but also for his idea that trade barriers are barriers also to lasting peace. That's all. I strongly believe in free trade. And I believe that open markets are, if not the best way of generating lasting peace, then the best way of generating wealth and opportunities. Free trade is the bedrock of the liberal world. It's a principle that can't be traced back to Adam Smith, David Ricardo, and even Keynes. They all agreed that free trade is fundamental to economic growth. And history shows that free trade has worked. It is, in fact, one of the greatest success stories. It has meant that millions of people have been lifting out of poverty, boosted economic growth, and helped tie countries together in peaceful relations. I saw a real concrete example of that last week. I was in Korea, participating with some Danish companies trying to selling their products in Korea because they're opening up markets right now because America is shutting them down, then they're opening up to Europe. And looking at the numbers for North Korea and South Korea, it was, of course, devastating to see what's going on in North Korea, but looking at just the economics, until the 1970s, the GDP in North Korea was higher than South Korea. So it was not the Stone Age, it was until the 1970s. And what happened? South Korea began to invest in education, they began to open up their market, they began to look at the liberal market economy, they began to look at export, imports, they began to open up their own markets. North Korea was closing itself even more than before. South Korea was opening up for its markets, and now the GDP in South Korea is 1,000 times higher than North Korea. Since the 70s. So that shows me that democracy, free trade, globalization is the right way forward, and we should never, never ever go back. And this is also the truth behind what's going on in Europe right now. It's the whole idea behind the European cooperation, that countries with close economic ties don't go to war with each other. Looking at the history, actually, I was considering very much studying history when I went to university. I didn't do it, but that was probably a shame, but I didn't do it. But looking at the history, European countries have always been to war with each other. And since we, not me, because that was before my time, but Europeans formed the European Union, it has meant economic growth. It has also meant the most peaceful time in history ever in Europe. For sure, the 28 countries in the European Union would never ever consider just considering planning something offensive against another country. And this is first time in European history since the Vikings was attacking their neighbors. So it has proven a success. It's built on capitalism, it's built on free market and free trade. There's no tariffs at all in between the 28 countries in Europe. None at all. countries like China, India, and Indonesia have and are still lifting millions of people out of poverty, even though they don't still even earn a lot compared to the average person in many countries in the Western world, including Denmark. They have experienced that their income have improved in large part thanks to your international trade. Only through fair and free trade can we offer an economic and social boost for our businesses, our workers, our consumers, and for our people. Therefore, it's a strong priority for us that our international partners remain committed to free trade and open markets on fair conditions. However, since the financial crisis, many countries have faced a range of political and economic pressures, such as slow growth and high unemployment. As a consequence, we have seen diminishing support for the free trade principles. We see this play out in protests against trade deals all around the world, demands for a rise of trade tariffs, as well as a rise of political parties that are critical of globalization. We have them in all European countries, including in my own fairy tale country. We see this growing skepticism at home in Europe with the Brexit exit on 23rd of June 2016 out of the European Union, and we see it abroad as well. The problem with protectionism is that it's rarely, if ever, confined to a single industry. Instead, it manifests itself into a whole restrictive system. Every industry becomes crucial and demands protection. Any gains that are realized in those industries become completely eroded as goods in every sector become more expensive, and the freedom for individuals to buy as they please collapses. In this context, I've noted the decision by President Trump to impose tariffs on steel and aluminium imported to the US. With all respect to my American friends and to the very good relationship between Denmark and the US, I don't think that's a wise decision. In our opinion, this is definitely not the way forward, and we are worried about the negative consequences that it will have for Americans, for American companies, for American citizens, for Europeans, for every citizen globally, because it could start and it could accelerate and it could have consequences, because then Europe has to respond, then Trump will respond, then Europe will respond, and then we could, hopefully we will not end there, but we could end with a trade war. And who will gain from that? Nobody. Nobody at all. All the innovation, all the developments will slow down, and all the progress we are making right now, technologically, and also getting people out of poverty, will stop. We believe that it's important to ensure fair trading conditions globally, but this cannot be achieved through protectionism and higher tariffs. That would be very bad for all of us. Rising protectionism poses a risk to our lives, our jobs, our open society. We cannot take the world as we know it for granted. We need to show political commitment and practical cooperation across the world. It is very important that we address and discuss this growing skepticism. But in doing this, we should be clear on what has caused the challenges that we face. As pointed out by the World Trade Organization, trade is not the main reason behind the job losses. 80% of the job dislocation is down to new technologies, innovation, and higher productivity. I'm not naive. Free trade is transforming our lives in fundamental ways. It changes the way we buy, how we produce, and how the way we live. There's no doubt that free trade means challenges. But free trade by itself is not the problem. it is part of the solution. We must ensure that our people will be able to perform well in a new digital world. We must do an effort to make globalization work for everyone. If we don't, the skepticism against free trade will continue. We should also constantly strive to make trade fair and more inclusive. This is why the Danish government remains a strong supporter of the WTO and the multilateral trading system. We are committed to a rule-based global trading system promoting free trade across borders, benefiting everyone, including least developed countries. But will the US and Europe also define the trade system of tomorrow? I believe we should. We should not let those with different views of markets, rights, standards, and rules decide. Together, we still have a chance to make the rules, not just take the rules. I believe that it's worth working for. This is my main message. We cannot safeguard our interests alone. We cannot meet international challenges with national answers. And we cannot seize the opportunities offered by trade if we build walls and trade barriers and close ourselves off to the world. I believe that we need a rule-based system of international free trade that ensures a level playing field. We need to have instrumental and dialogue that prevent or resolve these conflicts. That is why we have a shared interest in supporting the multilateral system that the US was instrumental in creating. And we need to keep the WTO as the core institution of global trade. And on another level, we must convince the voters across the world that trade is part of the solution, not the problem. Almost exactly 1 year ago, I listened with interest to President Trump's speech to Congress. Here he underlined his strong belief in free trade. He also said that free trade need to be fair. And I agree with this. And I hope that we can agree that free and fair trade is created by our common support for the established rules. I was in Davos in Switzerland this January for the World Economic Forum. Here he had many voices arguing that we must defend the principle of global free trade and that protectionism is not the answer. These are encouraging words. We face challenges when it comes to global free trade, but we must not allow ourselves to fall into the trap of the protectionism spiral, where consumers and businesses will suffer the consequences of new barriers to trade. Without access to trade and investment, developing countries won't be able to lift themselves out of poverty. We need to unite in our support for open markets and free trade. A strong free trade agenda remains essential for ensuring future prosperity and competitiveness on both the European and global level. People across Europe and the world are realizing that only by being engaged will you be able to shape the standards that will apply to global trade in the years to come. For every country who wants to slow globalization, there are fortunately those who commit themselves to shaping it. For every country who wants to retreat and isolate, there are fortunately those who realize there's no protection in protectionism. To quote a French political economist, diplomat, and one of the founding fathers of the European Union, Jean Monnet, he said, make men work together, show them that beyond their differences and geographical boundaries, there lies a common interest. Thank you.
Thank you very much for that support of international trade, which we definitely need these days. One of the questions that probably comes to our mind is first of all, when we look at Europe, as you mentioned, you clearly see a pushback against, if not free trade, but European Union and single market, which in a sense is pushing back against free trade. So again, you know, we looked at the elections in Italy, the results there, in Germany, in France. You know, the tide seems to be one of at least a greater number of the population showing skepticism about the value of free trade. So, you know, first of all, in a European context, you know, what can be done essentially to stem this tide? I mean, you know, at some level, and I guess President Trump problematizes this, it seems like there is a breakdown between understanding between leaders and populations about the importance of trade, value of trade, you know, whether this is actually a failure of political communication. I wonder what you think and what your experience is, at least in a Danish context, in terms of, you know, ultimately trade is now more of a political argument than, than an economic one.
Right now, we have a big discussion in Denmark about corruption, about digitization, and it's the same challenges, because the establishment is, of course, where we front of the changes, of the possibilities that it gives us for the world. Talking about digitalization, what means with new inventions, looking at the health sector and doing things better and more cheaper and so on, productivity. And it's the same with free trade, that we as the establishment are very fond of it because we can see the perspectives. But going out to an ordinary worker in Europe or in the States, I understand why they see the challenges. What about that job? If you work in a coal mine somewhere in the Midwest, yeah, you work in the steel industry, work in an industry that is very tough on competition, they're looking at, what about my job? And what we have neglected, I think, as politicians around the world and also in my own country is to explain why it's necessary. It's you don't do anything, it will all get worse. I think the best example is I don't know how much you guys here at John's office have been following the referendum in UK, the 23rd of June 2016, the Brexit referendum. Has been lots of surveys investigating why did they vote no. They actually joined the European Union in 1973 together with Denmark. We joined it because of UK, because that was our biggest trading partner. So we joined it because of them, and now we are staying and they're leaving. And asking why did the Brits vote no, because they voted no, even though a terrible wake-up call for most of us. Some of them because there was too many East Europeans working in UK. Some of a general skepticism of globalization, some because they thought they could get their own industry back, the car industry, production back to UK and so on. And that shows me that we have neglected in trying to convince ordinary Europeans and Americans that we can never go back to old times. Things are changing the whole time. So we have to change our society to be more competitive. And what will free trade mean for all kinds of people? It means that we use the market. The goods are going there where it's best, and productivity will rise. So to answer your, going back to answer your question, I feel that the biggest problem is among the establishment politicians. We have not been good enough in explaining the possibilities. We have created a scenario where people are very scared of the future, and that means they're scared of globalization, they're scared of free trade, they're scared of digitalization. And we have to come over that and explain the possibilities instead of the threats.
So connected to what you said, how do we separate, particularly in the European context, the fear of a cultural invasion of migrants from this fear of loss of jobs and what trade does? I mean, how much of this is about labor markets? How much of it is really about
trade? We have to do it in, let me take my own country as an example. As a, of course, as I told you, we're a small country, 6 million people. We have lots of migrants, like
going up to Northern Europe because we have probably the best welfare system in the world. So it's very attractive to come up to Denmark and Sweden and so on. But in the political atmosphere in Denmark, people are mixing them. Migrants, economic migrants, especially from Africa, going up from Central Africa and up to the Maghreb countries, going to Spain, Greece, Italy, and up to Denmark, and confusing with the people who are really working in Denmark. We have an independent survey done, analyzed, done by a very well-known research center in Denmark, showing that most of the foreigners grouped by nationality are a plus for the Danish society. And actually, the nationality that is most beneficial for the Danish society is not the Danes. It's people from Poland. So every child being born in Denmark by Danish parents is not doing as much for the society as the people that are working from Poland and so on.
How is that? What?
Because they come to Denmark when we have a very widespread welfare system, so every Dane gets lots of support for everything, you know, free education, free health, and so on. But when people come from abroad, they come when they're adults, they work, they pay taxes, and they leave when they get old. So we should actually import more foreign people to work in Denmark. But they are mixed up with the discussion about migration. And that shows me that we have failed. We have failed in arguing that this phobia about foreigners is connected to this discussion about globalization, this discussion about risking their jobs, is new technology and so on. And we have not been good enough in having the real discussion. What is the threat for our society? For my country, is actually the lack of workers. Right now in many industries in Denmark, we need people to work. And we would like to import foreign workers, but there's a big opinion about that in Denmark who's against it. And that's the same in many, many Western countries.
So, you know, all of our students here have to take international trade. So they
good subject.
Good subject. You know, as you've probably heard, U.S. Secretary of Commerce Wilbur Ross has sort of said the 25% tariff on steel, the kind of impact it might have on products that we consume in the U.S. which has steel in it is probably going to be negligent, which makes me think then why impose the tariff at all if it's not going to have any impact. But largely, I think the argument is, combined with the president's more sort of threatening tone, that it's better for Europe not to retaliate at all and let these tariffs just stand. So is that actually viable? Can Europe, why wouldn't Europe ignore these tariffs? Or why can it ignore these tariffs? And then how might it actually respond if these tariffs actually go into effect?
I actually had a meeting with Secretary Ross early on today, and we had a discussion about this. And he had been here together with me because we didn't agree totally on that, even though he's a businessman. I think Europe has to react because this is a threat to free trade, threat to globalization. And I'm a firm believer in globalization if we handle it the right way, handle it with UN goals and take care of environment, take care of poverty, take care of equal rights and so on, then free trade and globalization is good for everybody. So all the obstacles that you are putting ahead of the free trade, in we have to get rid of them. So if the U.S. will succeed with new tariffs on steel and aluminium, I'm sure that Europe will react. And they will—they have already proposed that they will put tariffs on bourbon from Kentucky, because the Senate leader is from Kentucky, Mitch McConnell. They will put import tariffs on Harley Davidson, maybe on Levi's jeans, and maybe on orange juice from California. And how will the Americans react to that? they will probably do something. Then we have to do something. We have something, and then we have to trade war.
And is there consensus across the single market in Europe in pursuing this path? Or
yeah, there's a consensus that we should do everything we can to prevent it. Nobody in Europe at all wishes a trade war. Nobody. And actually, except for UK, all the 27 other countries, that was a majority that we should have gone through with the TTIP. That would have meant the world for the relationship, the economic relationship in between America and Europe. And then such a shame it didn't happen. So there's a commitment in Europe that we should do whatever we can to pursue for free trade. But we also have to react if people are doing building fences and walls against free trade.
So if sort of the transatlantic trade relationship comes into trouble, will Europe be taking up sort of a different strategy with China, with developing countries, even maybe if the U.S. is opting out of broader multilateral trade? Do you see Europe basically stepping into this?
We have seen that many countries, including the countries you mentioned, are very interested right now in closer relationship with Europe. And we just signed a trade agreement with Japan. And that trade agreement has already boomed trade between Europe and Japan. Had one a few years ago with Korea. It had boomed the trade between us. And when we have one in India, it will boom. China is probably still very far away because of their ways of doing things, but we will have one in Oceania and so on. And people are looking at Europe right now, and that would also be missed opportunities for America, because then we'll just do the trade without.
So with that, let me open the floor to questions. Yes, this gentleman here. Please introduce yourselves also. Wait for the microphone.
Thank you. Jim Berger from Washington. Jim Berger from Washington Trade Daily. In the beginning of your talk, sir, you mentioned you're a strong supporter of free and fair trade. This administration, this Trump administration, is also a strong supporter of fair trade, which it seems that it defines as the benefits that accrue to one country under, for instance, a trade agreement should be replicated in the other country, almost in real terms. Is that possible?
I don't think it's possible right now, at least. But I think that there's a possibility that we also have to understand each other better, because what I have been noticing from my conversations with my American counterparts, second time I've met with Secretary Ross, is that there's some misunderstandings between that. Honestly, the American administration feels that they're being cheated by the trading partners, treating in some way, you know. And from our point of view in Europe, we feel there's a level playing field, and we should not change that. Every time this administration puts more tariffs on goods from Europe, then if there should be a level playing field, we should also put tariffs on. That will accelerate it, and that's what I'm fearing. That's why we have to stop it now and talk to each other and just look each other in the eye and see if there's really a problem here, we have to solve it, but we shouldn't solve it just by just putting it tariffs on something, because that will mean that we have to react.
Young, right there.
My name is Simon. I'm a current MA student here in the International Political Economy program. Thanks, Connors. I'd be curious to hear your experience, how the interactions with members of the administration, the U.S. administration, have changed over the years, and in these interactions, how your response might have changed as well. Thank you.
There's always a very sober and trusted atmosphere between the American administration and also my administration, because we're very close friends. So when you talk about that, there's no problems. I had a very good meeting with Secretary Ross, had a very good meetings with other ministers, and my colleagues have had very good meetings with members of the American administration. But of course, the signals from President Trump about trade policy, we don't agree with that. Because we are a firm believer in free trade and fair trade. And obvious that you can always say America first, I would always say Denmark first. But Denmark first, even though we are a small country, means that we would always take care of other countries and we will treat them equally, because that would also be beneficial for us. And that's the same for America. So I disagree with the belief that free trade would be harmful for America, because free trade means consumers will get cheaper goods, manufacturers will get cheaper productions, and your industry will get also cheaper goods, so they can produce more. So to answer your question, there's no change in the relation between change in the relationship between our administrations. Totally trustful, good friends, but good friends can also disagree on politics.
Any questions? That gentleman back there.
Thank you. Morten Tastum, Center for Transatlantic Relations. My question is in regards to TTIP and its demise. Do you think there is a possibility in the future of a TTIP-like agreement to be reached to sort of, should we say, have a fair playing field by completely removing tariffs in many sectors? Or do you see that as a political impossibility?
That could be a way forward, because my opinion is that whatever we can do to move towards a real TTIP would be good. So TTIP-like could be a way forward. I've been talking to the American administration about this, and also to Secretary Ross about it, and he promised me that they have not been giving up TTIP. So the American administration is not putting TTIP down the garbage can. They just want to look at it again, like they're looking at NAFTA right now. So we have to negotiate, but I'm not, to be honest, very optimistic about it. But we would pursue in any way, if it's possible to have a TTIP light, that could be a way forward.
Questions? This gentleman here.
Thank you. Steve Winters, independent consultant and graduate of Johns Hopkins. You mentioned the results of the recent elections and the tendency in that direction. Sometimes one of the reasons given for that tendency is the increasing unwinding of the social welfare state. France, for example, or Hartz IV in Germany. Obviously, the benefits are still tremendous. But nevertheless, there's this perception that the old German idea, Sozialmarktwirtschaft, yeah, that the market would also have a social component and a social responsibility, has somehow been lost with the neoliberalism of the sort of Dow's group. Is this a factor that you see in the results of the elections, or how do you interpret that criticism?
I see in almost all European countries right now there's a populist movement that gets about between one-fifth of the votes and one-third of the votes. Part of it is a reaction against what you called in the neoliberalism or something like that. But I think that's not really the truth. It's in a reaction against the changes, reaction against new technology, is a reaction of the future is not that predictable anymore, because things are changing so fast right now compared to before, that people are unsafe, unsecure. And these sentiments means that, as I said, between 1/5 and 1/3 of the populations in many European countries are seeking populist movements on the left and the right. And that's a main challenge, a big, big challenge for center parties, including my own, around Europe. So you saw Angela Merkel in Germany. She is the most powerful leader in Europe, and she hardly won the election together with, and she had to form the coalition with SPD that was signed just a few days ago. But she was the, nobody could threaten her, but she didn't win the election because of the right wing that got so many votes, the Green Party and so on. So Macron, everybody is yelling for Macron, the big saver for Europe, and I believe in him. But looking at the first election, it was four candidates. Far right, far left, a conservative, and a centrist like Macron. All four of them got about 20% of the votes. Then Le Pen, Macron got a little more than that, 23, 24. But all four of them got about 20% of the votes. Far left, far right. And Macron just won by a slight difference the first round. And then, of course, he won the second round because it was against Le Pen, so everybody was gathering behind him. But it shows me that in that's a very big majority that are very unsafe, unsecure about the future right now. And that's probably also why things are happening like they're doing it here in the States. I'm not an expert on that. But that's the same tendency.
Vikram.
Well, thank you very much, Minister, and thank you for your remarks. But I presume because time was short, you couldn't cover all the issues in international trade, so I wanted to raise, and globalization, I wanted to raise three which you may have missed, and I wanted your reactions to them. The first is, it's natural that we will focus on the urgent rather than the important, and so naturally the focus is on the tariff increases, but there's a far more important issue, which is the pernicious attacks that are taking place on the WTO. And the fact that there's an active effort to weaken an important global institution that buttresses the rules-based international trade system. What is Europe going to do about withstanding these attacks, and how will it shore up that system and ensure that it continues, at least for the rest of the world? The second question is that we know that with appropriate free trade at the border, countries have enormous access to instruments behind the border to tilt the level playing field in their direction. How far should international trade arrangements go behind the border before you feel they actually inflict or impinge upon national sovereignty, the right and of the rights of government to protect their citizens against shocks of various kinds? And the third is one dimension of globalization which you didn't touch on at all, which I think is an important complement to what's happening on trade, and that is financial flows. You know, the world has globalized financial flows which are becoming an enormous danger to the international system, including the international trading system. And despite and after the global financial crisis, there doesn't appear to be very little much that has been done to ensure that there are no contagion effects, and that the international global system for finance does support international stability. So your thoughts on all three. I apologize for putting three questions to you. Thank you.
No, they're relevant. If I were to make a lecture here, I would address them. But I was just, and I agreed with the dean, there was just some short comments. But I can touch upon the three questions you raised very shortly. First of all, the World Trade Organization, it's under huge pressure right now. And of course, Europe will do its utmost to protect it. I think it's more verbally that some in America is speaking against it, because when I've been speaking to the American, talking to the American administration, they are also convinced that there should be some structures in the world trading system. And actually, talking to Secretary Ross today, he was also mentoring the World Trade Organization system in our dialogue. But it's under pressure, and we have to be protective of it from Europe and also in America. Secondly, how your question is, the principles of free trade, how would I react if you talk about shocks, social shocks in other countries and so on? My firm belief, because I believe in free trade and I believe in capitalism, even though I'm not a liberalist, I think that the state should play a role in many things. Closed societies need to have shocks. Closed societies where institutions have been there for many years and protected the industry and protected the population means that they have not made the real innovation. They have not changed the society. So I'm not against shocks if it's for the benefits for the people and the businesses. So I would not be the judge to say I would protect people and the countries from implementing international regime because I think many countries around the world need the shocks. Looking at Africa right now, that's great potential. They need some shocks. Looking at some different Asian countries, they also need some shocks for the sake of the population. Third one was meaning that I'm a conservative, a capitalist, but again, I'm not a liberalist. So I actually agree with you. I think that we should be very much aware of what's going on with the really big organizations and companies. And in Europe, we're looking at it. We have to be ready to make some measurements about it, to make the right framework conditions so the decision-making process should always be at a democratic level in a political system, not made by businesses. Some of the businesses are so big now that they could make decisions that affect more than the political decisions, but they're not democratic. I always believe that democracy should have a priority instead of big business. So we are at a time where we have to consider internationally whether what we could do in that area. So I don't know what you believe in, but I actually agree with the perception in your question, with the third question, is that we have to take it seriously, that it could be a threat to the democratic system.
Well, thank you very much. I would say also just to sort of listening to you, thinking that, you know, trade between U.S. and Europe facilitated the two to do a lot of other things, including NATO and collaboration on varieties of things, and whether a sort of a spiraling trade conflict would actually impact the ability to collaborate and cooperate in those arenas. Thank you very much for coming to SAIS and spending time with us
Thank you
very
much
insightful comments. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.